Hi, I'm Tara Clark, and welcome to Modern Mom Talk. Today, I'm so excited to have three of my favorite moms on the show. We're going to be talking about overcoming, whether that's overcoming an eating disorder, overcoming divorce, or overcoming anxiety. Today, we're going to have Michelle Dempsey from The Michelle Dempsey, Kendra from Anxious Moms, and Linda from Fruits of Motherhood. Enjoy. And we're recording. So thank you so much for coming on. I'm so excited to have the three of you here. I respect you all so much. You are some of my favorite accounts. I love you as individuals, and I wanted to bring us all here today just to have a really cool conversation, get to know each other a little bit better, and then just sort of talk about things that were present in our lives. Today's topic is overcoming and what that means to us and what we have overcome and what we still have to overcome. And I'm just so thrilled to have these three women who I respect and adore so much on the show today. So first I'm going to start off with Michelle Dempsey from The Michelle Dempsey, and Linda from Fruits of Motherhood, and Kendra from Anxious Moms. So if you just want to give a wave, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for asking us.
Of course. So today's topic is overcoming. And overcoming can mean so many different things for so many people. It could be overcoming a divorce, overcoming mental illness, overcoming anxiety, overcoming the concept of wanting to be a perfect mother and wanting to perform in this modern world that we have now. And there's so many different things that are kind of pelted at us all the time that we're having to overcome. It could be, you know, having a traumatic childhood. They're just so, or even in a traumatic adulthood. There are just so many different things that we could talk about with this. And I said, you know, who are three people that I know could totally hit this out of the park? And you are seeing them right here. So thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
All of our problems are here for you.
So here we go. All right, you ready? Here we go. All right, Michelle. So I'm going to start with you, and I'm going to ask you, what does it mean to you to overcome?
So I love that question, because a few years ago, I wouldn't have been able to answer it. I think overcoming means truly experiencing what you have to experience, taking the lessons from it and learning them to avoid ending up back in that place ever again in your life. And I always say there's everybody in this world, it's a 50-50 split. You're either that person who goes through something and just can't pull themselves out of it and plays this victim role for the rest of their lives, like, why me? Oh my God. Or you say, yeah, I went through this, and that. It made me that much stronger. I'm past that now, and that is overcoming.
That's excellent. Can you tell us a little bit about your story?
Sure.
I know you often speak about being a divorced mother.
The divorce is sort of the icing on the cake. Like, I always say among my personal circles and to my mom and everybody who knows me, like, I was meant to get divorced. Like, I had to get divorced in order to reach this point in my life, because I had years of trauma in my childhood and well into my 20s. And I was not overcoming. I was sort of like, well, daddy issues, or, well, my dad didn't love me, so I'm just going to keep making these, can I curse? I'm going to keep fucking up, because why not? You know, I'm the queen of learning things the hard way. And so sure enough, I was running away from my problems, left New York, because I'm like, you know what? There's too much drama. There's too many bad memories. There's too much pain here for me. I'm just going to move to Miami. I decided on a week's whim, called, you know, an apartment, got myself a place to live, and moved within a week, thinking, if you run away from your problems, they can't follow you, right? And then 3 months later, after moving here, I was engaged to my ex-husband, which goes to show you I hadn't learned a thing. Because I didn't give myself time to heal. I didn't even give myself a chance to get settled in this new place and be alone with myself and figure out what it is that I wanted. I just attached myself to the first cute guy, you know, that I met at a bar. And so lo and behold, that process brought out all of the worst in me. I was at my worst. All of my demons were coming out when I was engaged. Naturally, we got married. I had a baby. And then once I held Bella in my arms, I was like, oh my God, how did I get here? And that was like sort of the unraveling of all the bullshit and me trying to have to put myself back together so that I could leave this marriage, so that I could be strong enough on my own. And I couldn't do any of those things without working through the past. So, you know, big reason why I'm attracted to Kendra's account is all of the, you know, the admitting that you're anxious and all these anxieties make you have these behaviors, but you have to work through them. I'm such a big believer in honoring my anxiety, calling my therapist all the time, and owning up to the fact that I've made a buttload of mistakes, but I'm not going to make them going forward.
I love that. Thank you, Michelle. Thank you for sharing your story, because I love that. And Kendra, I love your account because you are in my brain. Every post you make, I could have written that if I was more eloquent. If I could put words to my thoughts, that's it. I mean, you're phenomenal. So thank you for your account. So I want to ask you about your account and then ask you about overcoming anxiety or even just learning to live with anxiety.
Well, my account started a little over a year ago. I actually feel like it's been about 2 years. It was about 2 years in the making when my daughter went to therapy. And I would have never admitted that to anyone ever because I thought that made me a terrible mom. So she was 10 and she kept having a bunch of nightmares and she'd come into our room in and out. And I'm like, you are 10. You don't need to be coming into our room. And she couldn't get over it. Well, I'm afraid someone's in the house. And I'm afraid I have diabetes. She'd hear something. One of her friends has this. I have this. And I'm afraid I'm going to die. So finally, the doctor did show her she was healthy. And then I did a therapist, which I thought, holy cow, why is my 10-year-old going to a therapist? And when she went to the therapist, she said, that's just anxiety. And I'm like, what? But I still was not going to admit I had it. So I did a little Googling after. And I'm like, oh, I have anxiety too. But then I still didn't want to go to a therapist, nor did I want to tell anyone she was. So then I thought I would start anxiousmoms.com and I would write about it and see if anybody could relate to me. And then I did an Instagram and a Facebook, and it was still all private. Like, I wasn't going to put my name to it. I didn't want anyone to know, like, in the real world who I was, because I thought, oh my gosh, they're going to say I'm a terrible mom if my kid has anxiety. So I finally started going to the same therapist, who I still go to now, and she follows me on Instagram. She said she's going to put on her resume, therapist of anxious moms.
Yeah, I love that.
Hey, I don't want to say her name on here. I mean, I don't think she cares, but I'll say hey to her. She's awesome, and I've been going ever since, and I still go, and she chats me, and we message all the time, and I send her the mean messages I get.
Mean messages? Honestly, no, I'm serious. People troll you for some of these things?
Yes. It's fine. I guess it is what it is.
Part of the process.
But that's why I just didn't. Writing about the anxiety helps me. Like, people probably think, oh my gosh, she's so anxious. But actually writing about it and getting it out of my brain, that's what helps me to overcome. And I mean, I'll always have anxiety, but I think it won't be as strong as it was. Like, it was in my brain and I would spiral so quickly. That's what she tells me. Like, holy cow, you went from my husband's going to the doctor to my husband's going to be paralyzed and dead, like, in 3 seconds. Like, my brain spirals that quickly. She's like, it's like basically going down a slope, and I go top of the hill all the way to the bottom in like 3 seconds. And so I'm trying to rewire that, but it'll always be there. I think it's just recognizing it.
That's right. Totally honoring it and being like, you don't belong here, crazy thought.
Yeah.
Sort of like compartmentalizing it and saying, like, yes. I acknowledge that I'm having this thought, but I need to compartmentalize it, put it on the shelf, leave it there on the shelf, and don't recognize it for what it is. Just sit there on the shelf, crazy thought. Sit there. So thank you for sharing your story, Kendra, because
you're welcome.
For your account, really, like I said, every time you post, I just think, yes, that's it. She nailed it. I love that. And so thank you for being the voice for so many women and so many mothers out there, because it's hard to peel back the curtain and say, hi, I'm Kendra. This is me. I struggle with anxiety. And I know how hard that is to peel back the curtain and say, like, hi, I'm a real person behind this account.
Right.
But because then you're just, you know, putting yourself out there to be like, all right, now shoot all these bows and arrows at me, right? Like, go ahead, like, just hit me. But your account and your truth and your voice, and you're so authentic in what you say. And like, that's why people relate to you so well. And that's why I think that you just grew so quickly, because people were like, yes, I thank you for saying the thoughts in my head. And so thank you.
Which is crazy, because I felt crazy. I'm like, nobody can think like me. And then now I get all of these messages. That's how I think. And I'm like, whoa, no. And that's what helps me.
Kendra, I remember when your account was first starting, I messaged you and I was like, wait, this is the perfect Instagram handle. Like, how relatable is anxious moms? Like, I relate.
For sure. It's true. And for me, I feel like, and I'm going to ask you, all three of you, if you think that this is true too. I feel like motherhood made my anxiety so much worse that maybe I always was anxious, but it was just my own thing. And like, I was able to just deal with it or power through that my whole life. But then when my son was born, whether it was postpartum anxiety or whatever it happened to do, it just like skyrocketed. And then also like at certain points, like turned to rage when you can't, you know, keep a handle on that. So do you think, I'm gonna ask Linda first, do you think that motherhood brings out more anxiety than otherwise seen?
Hands down. I mean, I also didn't really recognize the anxiety that was in me until I became a mother and started having to do things that maybe I was uncomfortable with, or just simple things like letting my son go with someone else, I would lose it. And I didn't realize it was anxiety until having this conversation with my husband over and over, telling him like, I don't feel comfortable. I don't know how to explain it to you. And then just all of a sudden it was like, it's me, it's my anxiety. There's nothing necessarily that's gonna happen that's bad to my son while he's gone for 10 minutes, but it's me. And so I had to like teach him how to talk to me about my anxiety as well. Just being aware of it and knowing that it lives here in our house. I am the anxious mom.
Yeah, I completely understand. I am the anxious mom. Michelle, what about you?
My anxiety was always very much present. Mine came to a head when I was pregnant, I would say. I had been on medication on and off for a few years before I conceived, but once I knew I wanted to conceive, I went off of it, and I didn't do it with the help of a doctor. And I, if anyone here has ever tried weaning themselves off of something, not without a professional, it sent me into a tailspin. So the height of my anxiety was actually when I was pregnant, and I was very honest with my doctor about it. And I have to say, he was amazing. I had a lot of stress in my pregnancy. My marriage was awful. It was constant fighting, screaming, me crying. And at 29 weeks, my water started leaking, and I went into the hospital, and my doctor said, this is directly related to stress. And he's Latin, and I come from a Latin background. And he was very like, he just like curled up in the hospital bed with me. And he's like, mi corazón, you must relax. You have that glass of wine. Take care of you. And I was like, doctor, I can't manage my anxiety. And so he was very, the second I gave birth, he was in the room. How do you feel? How do you feel? He would call me every day. And at my 6-week checkup postpartum, I said, I'm going to lose my mind. I had postpartum anxiety naturally. I every day would wake up and look at Bella and be like, I have to do this again today. Like, oh, it was a horrible feeling. And so he helped me get on medication, and that sort of changed my experience. But then my anxiety ramped up again when I started co-parenting. Bella was 2, and up until that point, I had been 100% who took care of her. Even in my marriage, it was like, you know, I'm sure any mom can relate, divorced or not, but like the first 2 years, you're doing everything, and not many.
It's a mother's job.
Yeah, right. So all of a sudden she's in diapers, and I have to let her go to my ex-husband, who hates me, who purposely wouldn't answer the phone. And I would spend my weekends shaking, like unable to think, unable to do anything, crying on the phone with my best friends and my mom, like not sure what to do, to the point one day where I just showed up at his house. Cause I, in my head, I knew that he had died in the middle of the night, and she was wandering the apartment alone in diapers, and I couldn't get the thought out of my head. Obviously that didn't happen. So I was like, hey, doctor, we got to do something. And that's when I put myself back in therapy for good, to be able to deal with that and let go of some of the control. But you know, my anxiety comes and goes in waves, and it manifests in different ways. Right now with quarantine, it has manifested into obsessing over, you know, my body, which unfortunately I've struggled with an eating disorder too. So like I'm rife with issues. and anxiety will trigger it in different ways. But the difference between who I was then and now is I'm on top of it. Like the first thing I did was call my therapist and deal with it in a different way. And I, you know, I think the best thing is just to be at a point where, like you said, honor the voice, let it go, and don't let it seep into what matters most.
Yeah, that's great advice. Thank you for sharing that story though, Michelle, especially with the eating disorder too. And it's a lot. It's
a party.
And that's why you're here, because we love you. And this is like girlfriend talk, like sitting around, except we're all different places, but no different from if we were all just sitting around my kitchen table hanging out. Mm-hmm. So Linda, what are some tips that you would suggest for us that you keep in your mind when you need to overcome something, whether it's the overcoming a thought or overcoming a feeling or overcoming something that's happened to you in the past?
I try to recognize where it's coming from. Is it something that's going to happen, or is it something I think is going to happen? And that kind of helps me cool down, because I too can just race, like you said, thinking that your daughter was wandering the house and your ex-husband was dead. Like I get that. Like that totally spoke to me, that I could totally come to that conclusion. If someone didn't answer a phone call once, they're dead. And they, if they have my son, forget it. So I try to also make other people, I guess, aware that I am anxious. I have no problem saying like, I'm super anxious, I can't do that. You know, like just, it's about me, it's not about you, but I can't do that. I think just being honest with yourself first and vocalizing it with the people that it's triggering, I think that has helped me more than anything, just being aware.
Yeah. I agree completely. That's what it is. I think so much of it, especially now, the more that people talk about it, the more that they're going to be able to recognize it in themselves to be able to say, okay, that's what it is. Now I can identify this feeling. Because for me, like when I felt anxiety after my son was born, I didn't know that's what it was.
Right.
Does it make sense? Like you were just like, you just feel that buzz, you know, it's like a buzz that you sort of feel, but you don't necessarily like know what it is or put a word to it. And the more I talk to mothers and the more mothers talk, have these conversations themselves, then you can put words to it. And then you can then start to break it down. And then, like I said, compartmentalize it and put it on a shelf, right? So Kendra, for you, what are some tips that you use or that maybe you help your daughter to use to try to overcome?
Well, I think the biggest thing, like you said, is talking about it. Hands down, get it out of your brain. Because when you don't get it out of your brain, then it all spirals. Either you have to talk about it and talk through it with someone. So she and I, usually every night, she'll come to me and she'll tell me one thing. Oh. And she has gotten so much better with just, I know. And I said, no, I get it. You need to just talk about it. Let's just talk about it. And with me, I write about it. My husband's good at listening, but not quite knowing what to say back. And he even said,
mine too.
He's like, you're gonna do what? And he still doesn't understand this whole Instagram thing, any of it. And he's like, people don't need to listen to someone being anxious. And I'm like,
but we do. We
maybe like, you what? Don't. He does not get it. I told him he's clearly
you're
not.
Like such a force on Instagram. Like all of us have like people that wait for our posts, and the men behind the scenes are like, "Why do you do that?" Like I don't get it.
He doesn't get it. And I said, "Clearly, you're not my audience." And so we've agreed to just not talk about Instagram at all, which is fine. Sometimes I think you just have to agree to disagree and let it be, and we're perfectly fine with it. But he does not understand the whole talking about it. And he is definitely a bottler. Like he thinks he needs to just hold it in and not tell anyone about it. And I did that for years. But eventually you're going to explode, which I did. So that's where the rage, I think, would come from with me. Like I would hold in, and then I would just get so angry. Like, why is this stuff not working out? And I must have always been anxious. I mean, looking back, I think I always have been, but I was able to deal with it because I'd find ways to deal with it. Like, oh, okay, it's perfectly fine to be a perfectionist. People love people being perfect, but when I had a kid, I'm like, holy cow, I can't control any of this. Mm-hmm. But I was the same. I had that same feeling. I had no clue that everybody had those thoughts about worrying about their kids. I didn't know until mine was 10.
I think control has a lot to do with it, right? I don't know if that's necessarily like a thing that goes hand in hand with motherhood, is like you want to control the situation so that the kids don't get hurt, so that the kids feel happy, so that, you know, everything is just so right down the line. And, you know, real life's not like that. You know, we can't control everything. So I guess the only thing that we can try to do is just teach ourselves and to teach our children to just adapt and to take things as they come. And it's not what happens to you, but it's how you react to what happens to you, right? Yeah. And so I guess that's probably a takeaway that we could try to, you know, teach our kids from a young age, is that, like, you may feel anxious. My son also has anxiety. He's 7. I think it's just in the family. I like to think that it's not something that I passed down myself, that maybe he just happened to be born with genetically, but I don't know. But you know, he gets help as well. So, and that's even a big thing for me to even say publicly, because, you know, 7 is pretty young. But
guys, my 5-year-old is in therapy, so you're making me feel so much better.
Thanks.
And she started at 4.
You guys can make me cry. Thank you, Michelle, and thank you, Kendra. Okay.
Okay, now
we'll absolutely cry.
We're gonna all start crying here in a minute.
Okay. Thank you.
You're the emotionally unhinged group you've invited on the show. Thank you.
You guys, it's fine. We're not crying.
This is the God's honest truth. I'm not a crier. I mean, I could literally go for years without crying, and you guys just made me cry. So,
you were bottling up the crying. You're gonna cry all day now. You're letting it out.
But that's why truth amongst mothers is so important, because, like, Kendra, you started talking about your 10-year-old going to therapy. My stepdaughter had all the same anxieties at around that same age and the same problems with the sleep, and therapy helped. My 4-year-old, you know, you have to understand, she got thrown into a life of co-parenting at 2 years old. By 4, she was like, what the hell? I want to stay in one house. I don't want to go to 2 houses. And so I put her in therapy, mostly because I knew better. My issues went ignored as a child. So I was like, we are not repeating history here. And I think it's empowering for another mother to know that, like, I'm not the only one who has to struggle with this. And that's why we have to speak our truth. And that's why our husbands don't understand it. But we're making people cry and feel seen and feel loved all day long. And there's something really special to be said for that.
Thank you so, 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 so much for all speaking your truths and being here today. We're going to say goodbye now. So thank you so much, Kendra at Anxious Moms. Follow her. I'm pointing down there. So please follow Kendra at Anxious Moms and Linda at Fruits of Motherhood. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing your story. And Michelle Dempsey at The Michelle Dempsey. Thank you, ladies. Thank you for being honest, and thank you for bringing your true selves in this conversation. And I'm so grateful for you. And I know that your friends and your followers and all the people out there are so grateful for you too. So thank you so, so much for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.